thank you so much for coming out. This is the lineup announcement official for 2019, Blood in the Snow. Welcome you all here. Make some noise!
This is Kelly Michael Stewart, Festival Director of the Blood in the Snow Film Festival. Kelly.
Oh,
nice to see you too. Please tell me a little bit about the Blood in the Snow Festival. What is its raison d'etre?
Well, we're in our eighth year, and we are at the Royal Cinema November 21st to 26th, and we're a mix of features, short films, web series, and now podcasts for this year. So we're really excited about that. So we have a nice mix of it, and we play it. What's unique about us is that we're all genre festivals, we're all Canadian as well. So we're all Canadian, and we'll say, well, Canadian, when I say Canadian too, it's Canadian, but also Canadian co-production, anything like that. So we'll have like films that actually have like a UK director or a US director, but have been made in Canada, and Canadian crew, Canadian money, and things like that. So we'll have like, we'll keep it flexible like that. But yeah, we've been doing that for 8 years now, and we're at the Royal Cinema, and we've been growing. We're very much a filmmaker festival. We have a whole thing called Deadly Exposure where we do all our film industry events as well. So we have filmmakers fly in literally from all across the country. This year alone, we have filmmakers from Vancouver all the way to St. John's, all the way up to Nunavut. So it's like, it's pretty amazing, like how many like people will come. And they'll come like for a 4 minute short, they'll come here for 6 days and do all the events. So I find that's a real compliment to the kind of festival we have. And then we have them, and then we have all the film fans, people, all the horror fans. And we have people that were here tonight for our announcement that have been coming since 2012.
Okay. I'm Audrey Cummings. I directed the feature film She Never Died, which will be screening on the Friday the 22nd, I believe.
My name is Corey Mann, and I directed Willa.
Tell us about Willa.
Willa is like a campfire ghost story that it's a supernatural drama. It's a classic story by Stephen King, so we adapted it into a short, and and we put a thrilling new twist on it.
I'm Lauren Brandon. I edited for Director
Horny. Please tell me a little bit about this.
It's called She Never Died. It's a sister sequel to He Never Died, the Henry Rollins film from 3 years ago. Mm-hmm. It stars Olanuke Adeyeli, who's amazing. She's so good. And she's a fallen angel who's basically stuck to immortality on Earth for eternity. Uh-huh. And it's her trying to regain her humanity again.
Excellent.
And she's a cannibal.
Oh, and a cannibal. Okay, yeah. We'll just throw that in there. Yeah. Very cool. Take a minute just to discuss. There's a $1 option that Stephen King offers. That's what you took advantage of.
Yeah, so any student filmmaker or independent filmmaker can approach Stephen King's manager or agent pay a $1 option fee for a non-exclusive right to adapt one of his movies. It's really great. I encourage everyone to take advantage of it. It's awesome.
Absolutely, yes.
It was fantastic. There was such a great crew on this film, and so it made it really easy. You know, it was like the cinematography was great, the direction was great, and it just, the acting was fantastic. So it made it like a very nice process where there wasn't too much trouble kind of get all together.
Finding the story
exactly. It was there, which is really great. And I mean, it's based on a Stephen King story, so you kind of can't go wrong.
Hi, my name is Brian Coltry. I am a director and filmmaker in Toronto, and I have a film called The Trainee that's playing in the Funny Frights program at Blood in the Snow on Saturday, November 23rd at 4:30 p.m.
Hi, my name is Aaron Berry. I'm the co-writer and director of the feature film Magic, which is a science fiction UFO conspiracy theory film.
The Trainee is a superhero thriller comedy. We did it originally as a 48-hour film. It was a 48-hour challenge film from last year that we did very well, and we won a bunch of awards. It was a great time. But, you know, 48-hour films, you're kind of on a time crunch. You don't have really much time to do, like, you know, the best edit or the best visuals, or Lord knows, sound takes a backseat. So once the 48-hour film fest was done, I took it back and I was like, well, let's do some recutting, let's give it a sweeten it up, and then start submitting it up to the festival world. And we're very, very happy that Blood in the Snow accepted it, because this festival is amazing and I love it here.
The main character is Paula, played by Paula Brancati. She is a YouTube blogger in 2008, so YouTube has just started, and she's she gets a letter and meets up with an old man played by Richard Fitzpatrick, who claims to have been part of the Men in Black, Majestic 12, aka Magic. And she sort of goes down the rabbit hole and starts to piece together information that maybe this is true, even though she's very much a skeptic. She's very much in the mold of Dana Scully from X-Files. It's sort of like pitched in a way like she's a young Dana Scully, and she's very skeptical of anything to do with conspiracies, because most of them she can debunk by, like, you know, exploring the evidence. And she starts to believe this one, and then goes down the rabbit hole, and some weird things start happening to her.
It's like a superhero interrogation. So imagine the Punishers interrogating a bad guy for kidnapping a child, but then the Punisher, someone like the Punisher, has a sidekick who shows up and derails everything. It's the trainee.
The trainee. Interesting. What is your favorite horror combi of all time that you have programmed for bits?
Programmed?
Yes.
Wow, that's it. Actually, I would say I'm going to keep it in the puppet. You're going to hear a lot of puppets. I'm going to say probably from year two, we did a short film called Tasha and Friends. And it was based on very much like a Sesame Street style TV show, where the puppets, like, they basically get struck by lightning in the laundry, and they come alive and start killing everyone. And that one best short that year, actually. And they've actually gone on, people who made that short, they've gone on to have their own web series that played last year of it, and they continue to work with puppets. So it's a little ripping on Sesame Street, that too. So they played that too. So I think that's probably the most fun one we've ever had.
Yes, yeah. Now maybe you can tell me a little bit about the puppet theme that is continuing in this year.
Yeah, yeah. Our opening film this year is called Puppet Killer. So that's a Vancouver film by first-time director Lisa Overs, who's an actress that's been into directing and producing. And it's just really fun. It's just exactly what you think it is. But it's also playing on expectations too, like what a lot of stereotypes and tropes. They'll kind of that too. And they'll take that and then put it on its head.
Hey, you guys! I think I heard Jesse scream. No.
Yes. Did a puppet murder her?
No.
Are you all ready?
Oh, hell yeah. I'm looking forward to it. Yeah. Got all the weave we're gonna need.
I'm just really looking forward to going to chill for a few days.
Does anyone get reception? What if something happens out?
Like what, dude? Like, we're all gonna die.
You know how you always have, like, teenage actors that are not played by teenagers, but like 27? Well, the 16-year-old in it is played by someone in his 50s.
Nice. So. Other horror comedies that you have in your lineup this year?
Yeah, well, what's new for this year is we actually have a dedicated horror comedy program called Funny Frights.
Right.
And some of the highlights for that, the titles tell you all you need to know. And then there was another one called Video Vengeance that I was playing that was like a revenge thing that happens in iStore Video. And people that are fans of video stores that are still available in the city, they shot that there, and that was kind of fun as well. So, and one that's actually in the Emerging Screen program that's a comedy too is done by some indigenous children called Snack Time. And we did one called Frostbite last year. Follow-up films, and it's about more puppets. You know, this is all made in the Northwest Territories, so exposure is a big problem. So as a public awareness thing, the class did a film about the frostbite monster getting you if you don't bundle up. So now they've done this, and we played the film last year. It was a huge hit. We have it on CBC Metro Morning. Came all the way down for this premiere. They've done t-shirts since then, and they've done commercials for people. These are kids like in grade 5 that are like doing this. And they gave us a new film called Snack Time. And now it's a whole feast of different monsters. They've made all these other puppets. Like, they built the universe up. And now they're kind of coming back too. That's going to be in the emerging screen program. So that is hilarious. So that's another one that we're looking forward to as well.
For the sake of my blog series, which yes. is focused on horror comedy and B movies, I just wanted to ask you about any, if there are any particular horror comedies anywhere in the world that you love are your favorites.
Mine?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
And maybe some other.
I think you will like it as well. Horror comedies. Mm-hmm. Oh.
Yes.
I can't think right now what it's called. You know the one, the amusement park with the zombies?
Zombieland?
Yes.
Yes. That's a good one. That's
that
a good one.
That has always stayed with me.
I would choose between one that's actually a comedy and one that I just think is hilarious.
Okay.
The Shaun of the Dead, I would put, is my favorite.
My favorite horror comedy film, I mean, I assume I can change my mind tomorrow if you ask me again, but right now, it would be What We Do in the Shadows. I absolutely love that, and it's. I've been thinking about it even more lately. I literally 2 days ago just got an import Blu-ray, and fortunately I do have a region for Blu-ray player, so I can actually watch it, but I need all the extra features, so I love What We Do in the Shadows. I haven't seen the series yet, which I heard is fantastic as well, but I want to rewatch that film possibly in the next week or so.
The one that which might surprise people, I don't know if you've heard this series, I think Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the original.
Horror comedy, I was on a podcast a few months ago, and I said Evil Dead 2, and the podcaster Adam McDonald does Canadians talking shit. He got very upset because his favorite is Evil Dead, the original. And he's like, Evil Dead 2, of course you like Evil Dead 2. We worked together on Slasher, the Netflix series. He actually directed season 3 and I line produced that. So we sort of, he knows my taste, and I don't agree with him on a lot of things that he likes, but you know, we had fun. Anyway, so Evil Dead 2, not Evil Dead, the original.
Where the father that's practically dead and they're trying to feed like stuff to that, it's falling into the bucket. You watch it the first time and you're like horrified with it, but once you get past that, you're desensitized and you realize how funny. Because I think people were thrown off by the second one because it was like, because that was like much more on the nose funny.
That would probably have to be Beetlejuice.
Beetlejuice, excellent choice. All right, now.
It's actually a film that I saw at TIFF a long time ago, and I don't know how small or big this movie is, actually, but it was called Severance. Severance. And it was basically a group of coworkers that go up to a cabin, and it's kind of like The Office meets horror movie.
And could you tell me your favorite B-movie?
I still think it's Evil Dead 2. I think
movie. What exactly qualifies as a B-movie?
Well, Plan 9 from Outer Space.
That is really B.
Certainly, but even the, you know, the better films, Roger Corman, Edgar Allan Poe, Vincent Price Cycle, right. Things like that. A lot of the films that Vincent Price were in, I'd still, the high-quality B-movies.
Does Tremors qualify?
Maybe more of a horror comedy, and perhaps even a B-movie on purpose. So, sure,
yeah,
I'll take that.
Yeah, all right, okay.
I'll take that, absolutely.
I was thinking about a bucket of blood. I just saw a documentary on Dick Miller, and actually one of the first screenings I ever did in the city before I had Blood in the Snow was a screening of Bucket of Blood by that scene. And I think that's a great example of something that you can do. And I'll say this to tie everything up to Blood in the Snow.
Is that
what's great about some of the Corman stuff is very much the model of what you see with Blood in the Snow. There's a lot of heart put into it, but very fast, very quick. But you look at it, and in the films like A Bucket of Blood and Little Shop of Horrors, that the filmmakers that play Blood in the Snow I feel like they're taking a page from that. Because it's all kind of run and gun, and a lot of like low budget, early in their careers a lot of times like that too. And there's a lot of heart to it though. I think it's kind of like that. And I'm hoping that the films that honestly they're playing our festival will stand the test of time compared to maybe some of the bigger budget stuff.
Favorite B movie is The Locals, actually. So a man named Justin Declue had a film playing, he played Toronto After Dark a few years ago, a film called Impossible Horror. But his first feature film was a film called Teddy Bob. And Teddy Bob is it's kind of like a B movie, but it's more of like an homage to B movies and Hong Kong, like action cinema, all sorts of like gory horror effects. It's stars Peter Kaplowski, which everyone knows from Tiff Midnight Madness and also Turn After Dark, and he's just in the scene as well. And it's about this like slacker nerdy dude guy who gets this teddy bear that's sentient and talks and is also a bomb and it's going to explode. And he needs to get that bear from point A to point B, and there's all sorts of like weird espionage things, and there's tons of kung fu from people you wouldn't think can necessarily do kung fu, because I don't know if they can, but the film is so amazingly lovingly made that even though it looks in many ways like a super low budget movie, it also is extremely, like the filmmaking is extremely strong. And it's total, like I highly recommend seeing it. I think you can buy the Blu-ray pretty cheap directly from Justin DeClue, who you might know from a bunch of podcasts in the city too. He runs, I think he's doing a 24-hour film festival right now at the Grand Girard. He's showing 24 hours of B-movies.
Yeah.
So he's always around. So I would recommend Teddy Bomb, my favorite.
Well, I don't think there's any shame, at least not in my series, of being a B-movie. I made a B-movie on purpose called Space Zombies.
Did you?
Yes, 13 Months of Brain Spinning Mayhem. It was out on the Space Channel in 2004 for a little while. Yeah, for a few years. Yeah.
My favorite all-time one I can think of is the one, again, titles right now. You're going to tell me with this one. Female lead vampire. She walks around naked and...
naked?
Naked.
Naked.
Naked. And kills all the men. Take a spaceship.
Oh, okay. Maybe I don't even know this one.
It sounds super good. I'm drawing
a blank. I'll look around for it and post it on the blog if I find it.
And again, sort of following what you've been talking about, favorite Canadian indie horror comedy or horror?
The one that I go back to that I think is like a real touchstone to what we do in the indie world, like the turning point for me was Indie Cats. That was a big one. I think that one, and I love the sequels as well for those two, is that trilogy, I really feel like that, if I kind of look at that movie, it's kind of like the big bang of Canadian indie horror. I feel like before then, there was always this kind of little drips and drabs going on, and then from 2000 on, that's kind of like what I think of what we do, because it has that great subtext, obviously, about women coming of age story and all that kind of that too, and it's so well made at the same time, but it's a small movie, and I just, everything about it, I just feel like I keep watching that film every year, and it plays all the time. Like it has so much shelf life to it.
It does.
And I really feel like that one I just kind of always go back to. And there's so many people that actually work on our team, our talent coordinator actually got her start working on that film, I found out recently. And I know other people that have worked on those things like that. The Alex Kavanaugh, who did the costumes for it, worked on a project with her once. And so it's like, there's like things like that. It really was a touchstone for a lot of, I think even in another 15 years, I think that movie's going to be really looked back as a landmark film in Canadian cinema.
Absolutely it is. And it's got to be one of my most favorite werewolves. Yeah.
Paul Jones did a really great job on that one. And Canby did the other two. It was really amazing.
Finally got a werewolf movie.
And the people who did that, it was a long-time alumni for us, the Butcher Shop, is the makeup team that did that. And we've been playing films that they've worked on for literally from year one, actually.
Okay, one last question. Because this is the 13 Horrifically Silly Days of Halloween that I'm doing, what do you do for Halloween?
This year, we're actually going to go to the Rue Morgue Manor. They're having their own little party this year, which is fine. I've only been to the manor a couple of times. They have their own little space that's all where they have their offices. They call it the manor.
But thank you for all the people online watching us like that. I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you had a good time tonight. And just a little bit of a teaser of what you'll see in just under a month. So see you soon.